scripture for this week is Deuteronomy 16, 9 through 12. Count off 7 weeks from the time you begin to put the sickle to the standing grain, then celebrate the festival of the weeks to the Lord your God by giving a freewill offering in proportion to the blessings the Lord your God has given you. And rejoice before the Lord your God at the place he will choose as his dwelling for his name. You, your sons and daughters, your male and female servants, the Levites in your town, and the foreigners, the fatherless and the widows living among you, remember that you were slaves in Egypt, and follow carefully these decrees.
Thank you, Xavier. You're the only person in the room taller than me, always. Well, good morning, everybody. How are we?
Good.
What is that I see outside? Is that sunlight? It's been raining here for a long time, right? The problem with Washington is, if you research it historically, the whole town's built on top of a marsh. So after the rain is usually the most disgusting, humid time. But we have sunlight, so that's good, right? Well, my name is Ryan. If I haven't met you, I'm the pastor. Love to meet you afterwards if you have a second. Thanks for being here today. You know, as far back as I can remember, I have been a person of particularity. The upside of that is that I see all the details. The downside of that is that I see all the details. My mom has often told me that parenting me as a child with this disposition was challenging for her at times. She told me a story a few years ago about how I went into a violent temper tantrum one night at the family dinner table as a young child, and she couldn't figure out why I was upset, and after she finally got me calmed down, she was able to get me to vocalize why I was so angry. And come to find out, I was refusing to eat the meal and was throwing this temper tantrum because the peas and the corn on my plate were mixed together instead of separated into piles. I don't remember this, but knowing who I am, that's probably true. That sounds like something that would upset me. Even today, if you were to sit across from the dinner table from me, you would see that I eat one item on the plate at a time. I don't go back and forth between the vegetable and the starch and the protein. I eat one thing, then I move on to the next. And on a side note, I suppose that makes it particularly difficult for me when I'm eating something like ramen or pho, which where everything's mixed into a bowl, but I manage, even with chopsticks, to eat one item at a time. A friend once said to me, "Would you ever like to meet Jesus and have a conversation with him, Ryan?" And I said, "Sure, of course. Like, who wouldn't want to sit down with Jesus for a few minutes?" And then my friend, who knows me all too well, continued, "Well, if you ever did, I would imagine you would spend the entire time critiquing the scruffiness of his beard and his long hair and his dirty sandals, and you wouldn't even remember anything else about the conversation." That is also probably true. Being wired this way, one of the things I've been very slow to learn over the years is to stop and celebrate things along the way in my life, even though they may not be perfect or exactly as I want them. It's not that I'm not a celebratory person. It's just that, honestly, I see most celebrations as a waste of time and capital. This makes me a terrible friend to have in your life for things like birthdays or graduations or weddings. For instance, your wedding. You spent $25,000 to have your friends and family fly to your city so I can read some nice words and then sign a legal document for you. Why? Wouldn't it make more sense to spend the $25,000 on something else? I'll still say some words and sign the papers for you, but we could do that back in my office for free, and then you could use the $25,000 to buy a car or put a down payment on a condo or something. But no, instead, why don't you take that $25,000 and spend it on prime rib and Big Z and an open bar and hotel rooms for people you'll probably never see again until they're at your funeral. I know, I'm a terrible person. I'm awful. But truly, I'm not. I care that people care. I really do. And if you're happy having that kind of a wedding, I will jump in with bells on and celebrate it with you. I'm just not the guy you want to come to and ask how you should spend $25,000 on your wedding. Today is Pentecost Sunday. And if that is a foreign phrase to you, let me briefly explain what that means. Pentecost is a word that simply means 50th. 50th. Historically, Pentecost was a Jewish festival that happened during something called the Feast of the First Fruits, where the people of ancient Israel would all gather together to celebrate the harvest. This happened every year, 50 days after Passover. That's why it's called Pentecost, 50th, 50. We see the celebration of Pentecost in the New Testament in the second chapter of Acts, with the descent of the Holy Spirit on the disciples. And again, as I do every year, here I stand today scratching my head thinking, why do we have to celebrate this every year? I don't want to celebrate this. Wouldn't we be better off having come to this place learning about something more concrete, more practical, more useful to our lives? What's the point of remembering Pentecost? And then, also every year after my weekly studies and prayer and writing, I see why we're reminded to celebrate this. Because if you're wired like I am, not prone to celebrations, Pentecost reminds us to stop and celebrate. It is literally celebration for celebration's sake. It is the celebration of celebration itself, just like that. Pentecost reminds us to stop and smell the roses, not to assess how and when they were planted, not to critique the soil or the flower bed or the colors of the roses, not so we can begin strategizing about how to make better roses next time around, but to exercise the spiritual discipline, to stop and say, we planted these roses, they bloomed, and now we're going to pause and celebrate their beauty instead of trampling them into the ground on the way to the next thing. And we need this. We need to do this. We need to be reminded of this because for many of us, myself included, we don't have a rhythm of celebration built into our lives. We might celebrate the bigger things that everybody else does, sure, but what about all of the things that we so easily overlook in our lives that we actually have cause to stop and celebrate? The rabbi Abraham Heschel wrote this once about thankfulness and celebration. He said, "The people of our time are losing the power of celebration. Instead of celebrating, we seek to be amused or entertained. Celebration is a confrontation, giving attention to the transcendent meaning of one's actions." That's a good reminder for us. Heschel says that the celebration of things can become so forgotten that the very act of celebration is in and of itself confrontational in nature. As if we are saying to life and the busyness of it, no, I'm not moving on yet. I'm staying here for a second. I'm going to pause and I'm going to take joy in this for a second, even though everything behind me is trying to force me on to the next thing. I'm going to pause and be thankful and celebrate. The passage from Deuteronomy says, "Rejoice before the Lord your God at the place he will choose as a dwelling place for his name." Well, what is God's dwelling place? You, people, are God's dwelling place. And not just those of us here, but all of us in the world. God lives in people. That 21 grams of us that's missing after we breathe our final breath. You, your sons, your daughters, your male and female servants, the Levites in your towns, the foreigners, the fatherless, and the widows living among you. No matter who you are, no matter what you are, no matter where you are, no matter what label you are called by, we are all called to pause and celebrate. Remember that you were slaves in Egypt. We cannot forget, even though we have a long way to go, just how far we've come. Maybe all that we did was survive up to this point. And that is a monumental achievement that can be celebrated. And finally, the text ends by saying, and follow carefully these decrees. Pausing to celebrate, pausing to give thanks, pausing to be grateful is just as important of a command as any other command we see in Scripture. And not only that, it's good for us. It's good to be thankful. It's good to celebrate. It's good to acknowledge all that we have to be grateful for. There was a cognitive scientist by the name of Susan Pierce Thompson that was featured in Time a few years back, and she had done all of this research about being grateful, about being thankful. And in her studies and in her research, she found that people who took the time to write down three things that they were thankful for each day, something that she called the Three Things Challenge, she found that they showed considerable improvements in depression and in overall happiness in as little as a couple of weeks. And she said in the article in Time, if there were a drug that did that, whoever patented that drug would be rich. Gratitude is very powerful. This is the reason God commands us to celebrate, to be thankful. It's not just God giving us a command for command's sake. It actually helps us to be happier people. Now, what does that mean for us practically today? How do we put this into practice in our lives? Well, it certainly doesn't mean that we need to give up on our critiquing of things. Critiquing of things is good. Evaluating things is good. Reviewing things is good. That's how we improve things. But if we can only ever walk along in the journey of our lives critiquing things and noticing what they aren't, and that hinders our ability to be thankful, we are being robbed of something in our lives that we are desperately in need of. For instance, I'll give you an example from my life just this morning. As you know, it seems that it's been raining for 40 days and 40 nights here, right? This is our first day of sunshine. And when it rains for that long, I mean, there's really no boundary between the grass and the sidewalk. Everything just kind of turns to mush. There's mud, cut grass flows out into the sidewalks and the roadways, and our shoes pick up things. And I got here early this morning, and I walked in through the back doors into the sanctuary, and I noticed that some grass had gotten tracked in on the carpet. And that was all that I could see. I was just focused on this grass. I didn't see the rest of the space. And I had to catch myself for a second in that moment and look up and look around and be thankful. And though I didn't want to do it, I made myself walk to the front of the auditorium here, and I just stood right there. And I just said out loud, in opposition to the grass on the carpet that was driving me bananas, I said, I'm thankful for this place to worship this morning. I am thankful that we have light and electricity and air conditioning. I'm thankful that we can gather in this place as a community and worship without fear of oppression or violence And then I went back and I picked up the grass. And what I wanted to say when I walked in this morning was, oh, there's mud and grass all over the carpet. This rain's been going on for weeks. It's just been awful. And let's just lock the doors. I don't want to deal with this today. I know that sounds crazy, but I'm just that insane. I get upset over the little things. But the truth is, the grass was just this one tiny thing. And it was my choice whether or not I focused on that and magnified that, or I focused on the reality that there was so much more around me that I could celebrate. And that's just how life is. It's in those little things we're presented with in every moment of our lives. We can use our energies that we have, which are limited, to curse the traffic, or we can use them to be thankful that we have a car and that we have roads to drive on. We can be upset and angry about where we live and what kind of a dwelling place we don't have, or we can pause and be thankful that we have a place to live. We can rail about all that is wrong in the world, or we can pause and be thankful that our mind and the minds of many like us are working on solutions to right those wrongs. We can detest the job that we have, or we can be thankful that we have a job at all. It's always our choice in those moments to see the negative or to see the positive. God is always there with us in the moment, reminding us that even though there is a lot wrong, and there always will be, there's even more that's right and good and something to be thankful for. And that is the lesson of Pentecost. Yesterday, I had one of the greatest honors and privileges as a pastor is to be with families when they lose a loved one, to officiate the funeral of their loved one. Yesterday, I was with a family here in the church. The mother's mother and the daughter's grandmother had passed away, and overseas, and we were here in Bethesda having a memorial service. And those are always really difficult moments for pastors, because most of the time you're going into a room with people whose feelings are at their very height and you've never met them before. And you don't know quite what to say or quite how to say it. And so we began the memorial service there, and I was reading through my notes, and it just kind of felt heavy. People didn't quite know what they were supposed to be feeling or how to process it. Were we celebrating? Were we grieving? What was going on? And then we took a few moments in the middle of the service to just let the family members share some of their memories, some of the stories that they had about this dear woman's influence in their lives. And it was strange, and I'd imagine it's just coincidence, but it was as if when they started telling these stories, the room became brighter, the atmosphere felt lighter. It just didn't feel so heavy anymore. There was even laughter amongst the tears. And there in that room, even in the face of death, people chose to pause and celebrate the many good things that they had experienced from the influence of this woman in their lives. And we went away from that memorial service, at least I did, feeling uplifted, feeling encouraged, grieving the loss, sure. Knowing that death is final and hard, sure. But going forward in hope and carrying the good things with us that happened into the future. And it was a life-changing experience. Wherever you are in your life today, whatever comes across your plate this week, even if that is your plate and your peas are touching your corn, whatever you're presented with, always question that first reaction you have to things. It's so easy to just respond with pessimism and negativity. But you always have the choice to look at something that at face value just looks awful. You always have the choice, and you certainly have the depth to see something good in it. Mother Teresa used to say when she would go throughout the streets of Calcutta and was just ministering to people that were literally dying, just rotting in the street. She said she would go out every morning and minister to Christ in all of his distressing disguises. What if we looked at the problems that we face in our lives that way? Not just as some sort of mental exercise, but really believing that even the hard things that we come up against, even the things that are dissatisfying to us, are opportunities to recognize good. That could literally change the entire outcome of not only your week, but your life as well. Living with an attitude of thankfulness, gratefulness, appreciation, and love. Let's pray.